It's now Juan Ruiz Lorenzo going to talk, as it says up there, on numerical characterization of the spin gas phase, historical account.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much to the chairman. Thank you very much to the organizer for giving me the opportunity to speak here. So for me, it's a real pleasure to be here. I was here as a postdoc during 4 years in the 90s. I have a colleague, a Jorge Curcha, Leticia Gugliandolo, David Dean, David Lancaster, Remy Monasson, Matt Potter, etc. Undergraduate students as Federico and Luca. So it was a really, really nice time for me, and very intense. So this is the structure of the talk. The organizing committee has asked me to devote some time to do some history or to tell you the history of some numerical simulation. So I will start discussing. The different theories, the droplet scaling theory and the replica symmetry breaking theory, and the talk is structured in three different independent, in some way, blocks: numerical studies of the phase transition infinity dimensional spin glass in no magnetic field, numerical characterization of the spin glass phase in infinity dimension, the replicon. I will focus on this object, and finally I will discuss briefly the phase transition in the Edwards-Anderson model in 3 and 4 dimensions. Okay. Finally, some conclusion and an open problem. Okay, related talk, there is Andrea Majorano will speak about numerical simulation in the Sarrinian Gibbs pattern model. I will address briefly the metastate, but I refer the audience to the Peter Young talk. The behavior in presence of magnetic field was addressed yesterday by Nick Reed talk, numerical simulation in 2 dimensional spin glass by Martin Weigel this morning. And finally, there is an interesting poster by Ilaria Paga about numerical simulation in spin glass in film geometry. There is a very interesting because they address experiment directly. Okay, briefly, the main competing theories which try to describe the behavior of the low temperature phase in spin glasses are, the first one is the droplet scaling theory, was introduced by Mike Moore and Alan Bray and Fish and Hughes. It's based on the Migdal-Kalanov implementation of the renormalization group, which is exact in 1 dimension. The low temperature phase has only 2 period states which are related but a full spin flip. This is a global symmetry. Compact excitation of fractal dimension, dF less than d, and there is the excitation growth in equilibrium like with the theta exponent and in the dynamics like with the c exponent. An important result of this approach is any amount of magnetic field destroy the spin glass phase. So there is not a spin glass phase in finite dimension. And finally, there is a trivial probability distribution for the overlap, for the normal and for the lingua.
Sorry? The prediction would not be that a field destroys it.
Okay. The second approach is the replica symmetry breaking, was introduced initially by Giorgio Parisi. There is a work by Miguel Vidasoro, Matt Mezar, Toules. This is the solution of the Sarrinian-Gibbs pattern model in infinite dimension, so it's the solution hole in infinite dimension. There is an infinite number of pure states not related but any kind of symmetry. This pure state are organized in intermediary fashion. There are a spin glass phase in presence of a magnetic field. And the excitation of the ground state is space filling. And there is the overlap equivalence. All the definition of the possible definition of the overlap are equivalent. This is one of the famous Federico figure. This is the probability distribution of the overlap. This is the droplet scaling prediction. This is one step replica symmetry breaking, and this is full replica symmetry breaking. This is the three different behavior of the probability distribution of the overlap depending of the degree of the replica symmetry breaking. Okay, the starting point, we have the solution which hold in mean field. We can write the Gimbrough-Landau Hamiltonian for the model. This is the effective action. This is the standard Gaussian piece, and there is a the cubic and a quartic term. This AB, there is a field theory for a matrix QAB with square gravity overlap, and at then we need to put n equal to zero in order to recover the replica trick. In the paramagnetic phase, the propagator is the standard one, and in the, at the critical temperature, it's possible to show this lambda, this term is irrelevant from the renormalization group point of view, so this is a phi to the cube theory, and the upper critical dimension is 6, and the propagator is the, take this this way. What happened in the low temperature phase? So here we need to perturb the Parisi matrix. This was done by Dominici's Condorat Temesvari. Now the lambda term is relevant. So the structure of the propagator in the low temperature phase is a bit complicated. There are three algebraic decay in this phase depending of the value of the Q, of the state Q. For the maximum value of Q, this exponent is d minus 2 in the Gaussian approximation. For this intermediate Q is d minus 3. This will be modified below 6 dimension. And for the replicon, this is the minimum value of the overlap, is d minus 4. The prediction of the droplet scaling theory, there is only one possible overlap. There is a algebraic decay. There is only one correlation function. In both models, in both approximations, the low temperature phase, the spin glass phase, is critical. You see here there are not exponentially decay of the correlation function, there are algebraic decay like O(n) models in three dimensions. Okay, so an equation. This is the Edward Anderson Hamiltonian, the overlap, the Edward Anderson order parameter. There are two real replicas in order to compute this order parameter using sigma and tau, and we can define the link overlap just a scalar product of two Qs. Different observable, we have the correction function in the spin glass channel. This is a factor 2 here. This is a power of 2 additional. The susceptibility spin glass susceptibility is just the integral. We can define the Wiener cumulant in the usual way, and we can define the second moment correction function using the ratio of the propagator or the correction function at the zero momentum and the minimum available momentum in, for instance, in periodic boundary condition. This object is only a correction length in the paramagnetic phase. In the ferromagnetic phase, it's no longer a correction length and diverge. So this ratio, H2 over L, should behave like the Wiener cumulant, so at the critical point, should cross. They will mark, and the value U4 and this ratio is universal at the critical point. All the model belonging to the same universality class should provide the same value of U4 and H2 over L at the critical point. Okay, this is a typical out equilibrium configuration. There are here yellow and blue, yellow and blue, and the overlap, you can see the structure in terms of the overlap. Okay, some history. The first studies of the phase transition in absence of magnetic field was by Ojewski and Morgenstein in 85. This is an out equilibrium numerical simulation. They compute the decay of the correlation function, and with the decay of the correlation function, they can obtain the relaxation time. They study the relaxation time, and they characterize all the critical exponent and the critical transition. Just in the same volume of physical review letter, there is a paper by Peter Jahn. This is a more standard approach, this equilibrium. This is the U4, the Wiener cumulant, as a function of the lattice size. You can see here there is a merging of the curve, but there is not clear there is a crossing point or the curve directly merge or whatever. So with this plot, there are three scenarios. A standard phase transition, the second scenario, a zero temperature phase transition, or a scenario a Coster-Izaules phase transition. In 96, again, Kawashima-Yan, here, this is the merging, but this is a magnification of the plot, and you can see, you can start to see the cross of the different lines. In 1999, Sergio Caracciolo and Matteo Pallasini simulation only in the parametric phase. They compute the correlation length, the suggestibility. They extrapolate the observed to infinite volume using the method introduced by Sergio himself to infinite volume, and you can try to fit the divergence of the correlation length as a function of temperature and this quotient in order to obtain the anomalous dimension of the field. And finally, in 2000, the SUO collaboration, there is now, using the correlation length, there is a clear crossing in the three-dimensional spin glass. And here you can see, for instance, the XY model in two dimensions. This is a constellizable phase transition. There is clearly here a merging in the low temperature phase of the XY model. So clearly the phase transition at certain zero magnetic field in three dimensions is a standard one, and you can compute all the critical exponents. Okay, a check of the upper critical dimension was done by Wan and Jan in 92, and they obtained the classic mean field exponent. This is the crossing point of the Binder cumulant. They mark the transition. There are bigger errors, but you can see here the transition point. Here is the behavior of susceptibility with the lattice size. They obtain L to the square. This means eta equal to zero with a logarithmic correction with R natural at the upper critical dimension. And they obtain the exponent of the logarithm as 0.64. Okay. In 2000, I was able to compute analytically using the renormalization group this exponent, and this exponent turned out to be 2 over 3. So the agreement is, congratulations, this is very difficult to obtain a logarithm power in numerical simulation. So, really nice.
Is this in six dimensions?
Yes, this is six dimensions. We have discussed the upper critical dimension. Now we will discuss the lower critical dimension. There is now it's clear it's below three dimension because the history of the different paper I have shown you. So there is the paper by Boetcher using the behavior of the stiffness exponent with the dimension. You can fit the stiffness exponent in order to know at which dimension this stiffness exponent is zero. So the prediction of Boetcher is 2.5. And there is a beautiful paper by Silvio Fran, Miguel Virasoro, and Giorgio Parisi, and recently by Astuti Fran Aparisi. They compute the defect energy analytically using replicas, putting two interfaces, and they obtain the behavior of this object scale like d minus 5 over 2. So the lower critical dimension in this approach, again, is 2.5.
Yes.
When you put in the boundaries the value of overlap Q1 and the overlap Q2, and you compute how is the increment of the free energy analytically. So the summary, we have a clear phase transition between a paramagnetic phase and an spin glass one. This is the critical exponent. The more precise values were obtained by the Janus collaboration. The upper critical dimension is 6, the lower critical dimension is 2.5, and there is the issue of universality. We have different models. Numerically, we can use a Gaussian coupling, a bimodal coupling, etc. All these models belong to the same university class. This was studied by Krasbecker, Körner, and Peter Jan in 2006, and the answer is yes. Okay, this is to relax a bit. Part of this work has been done by Ojerski dedicated computer, by the Spanish and Italian transputer reconfabulator machine with the Apecento machine built here in Rome. And there are different machines based in a special device, computing device, like spin update engine, super spin update engine, and the two versions of the Janus computer. Some photos here, this is the old reconfigurable transputer network. It was One was in Zaragoza, and another machine was in Rome 2 with Giorgio in Tor Vergata. This is Apecento here, built here. The alma mater of this project was Nicola Cavivo. This is the chip, this is the tower, and this is the board of this Apecento. This is a board of the SUE machine. And this is Hanus One. This is the presentation in Trento. This is the board. And this is the Hanus Two. And you can see the difference between the fashion of the first design. This is Spanish design. And this is Italian design. As an anecdote, the company which built physically the rack is the same company which provides electronics to the Ferrari cars. Okay. Okay, I have used during this time different algorithms, but this is very important. It's very important to have a powerful computer and powerful algorithm. Well, we have used normal Monte Carlo, simulating annealing, microcanonical method, simulating tempering, Monte Carlo chain or parallel tempering. Now, Magda, using Fukushima and IVA paper, is start to use population annealing. You can use multi-spin coding in higher dimension, okay? This closed the first block of the talk. The second block is to focus in the replicon. The replicon is the propagator which lives in the Q equal to zero sector, ergo this sector or phase. So we will start to, this is a simulation in six dimension. In six dimension we know practically everything. We know what is the critical exponent at the critical point. This is an exact value for. We know at the critical point the propagator is 1/p², the anomalous dimension is 2, and the replicon below TC is 1/p⁴. So we can compute the susceptibility in the off-off equilibrium dynamics. In this off-off equilibrium dynamic, we will start in a disordered configuration, so we will start in Q equal to zero. In this situation, if replica symmetry breaking hold, there is a pure state with these properties. You can compute what is the correlation function associated with this ergodic component or this phase. So the prediction is the value of this exponent is 1/2 at the critical point and 4/θ dt assuming this. This is the result of the numerical simulation. There is the value, this is near 0.5 at the critical point according with this, and you can see the discontinuity of the function in the spin glass phase. So the extrapolation of this is near 1. This is the prediction of assuming this low. But this law is not part of replica symmetry breaking. Okay, this is a phenomenological law. We have found this law work extremely well in 6, in 4, and in 3 dimension. But this one, p⁴ propagator, is a consequence of replica symmetry breaking. Okay, we have studied more in detail this propagator in 3 dimension, computing the overlap correlation function. And this overlap correlation function in the broken phase, in the spin glass phase, decay with an exponent, but decay to zero. The prediction of the droplet model is decay to a constant. The constant is the Lorentz order parameter to the square, plus algebraic correction with the theta droplet, the exponent of the droplet model. At equilibrium, we need to recover this exponent, theta zero, should be 1 + eta. This is standard scaling. And obviously, assuming a general law like this and computing this kind of integral, the ratio of this integral are proportional to the correlation length. This is the result. There are 4 curves here. The from the below, the first and the second are out of equilibrium numerical simulation. We extrapolate this function to infinite time. This is directly this curve is directly a quench. This is a disordered configuration, and we put this configuration just in the spin glass phase. The second curve is a slow simulating annealing of the disordered configuration to the target temperature. And the first curve is the equilibrium, the full equilibrium correlation function. If in an equilibrium function we pick only the configuration with overlap for instance, less than 0.01, we will obtain this curve. So you can see the slope of this curve and the of out of equilibrium curve, the slope is are essentially the same.
So what temperature is that?
0.7. 0.7 TC.
That's 3 dimensions.
Yes. So we can show, I have no time, but we can show in the last year we have shown this in this temperature there are no critical effects from the critical point. There is a pure spin glass behavior at this temperature. Okay. A more detailed study of this theta zero, we have obtained 38 out of equilibrium with Janus, 38 essentially at equilibrium. And we have studied the metastate in 3 dimensions, follow the Reed paper, and we have computed, we refer for more details to the Peter Jan talk, we have computed this exponent numerically is 2.3 at equilibrium, which is less than 3, so the metastate is dispersed. And even Reed conjectured that this exponent is related with the replicon 1. So if you put here our 0.38, this is the prediction or the conjecture by Reed. This is 2.6, and we have obtained 2.3 with an error or C. We have studied the behavior of the maximum overlap obtained in this one. And we have enabled to obtain signature of the exponent with control, the overlap between zero and the maximum one, as predicted by Dominici's Condor et Temesvari. At the moment, there are no signature of this intermediate exponent. Now I will try to run, to be in a hurry, to discuss the magnetic field. So we will use the second moment. Now we need to modify the correlation function in order to take into account the connected part because we are in a phase with overlap. Okay, this is the first figure by Krasberger and Peter. This is a 3D. This is a magnetic field, a random magnetic field. This is irrelevant to have a random or not magnetic field, and there is not signature of the phase transition in 3D. Okay, this is clear. However, this is the prediction. On the left, this is the prediction of replica symmetry breaking for magnetic field. There are two delta peaks, and there is a continuous bar between the delta peaks. And there is from numerical simulation. As you can see, this is zero. You can see the negative tail overlap of the different probability distribution. Yeah? This is really strange from the numerical point of view. So you need to have the overlap in the droplet or in the replica symmetry breaking in the positive region. But numerically, we are simulating in a region of magnetic field and lattice size in which the probability distribution has long tails. And this negative overlap region induces large scalar correction on this propagator. In order to solve this, we avoid to use the zero momenta in the definition of the correlation length. We define another cumulant. This is the ratio of the propagator at two different from zero momentum. And we have checked this behavior in the normal model with no magnetic field, in the Ising order model, and you can check the transition with this new observable. Now, this is four dimension, so there is no signal for the normal correction length over L, but there is a clear, across of the different line for the new R12. So we can determine in 4D there is a phase transition in magnetic field. This is the exponent. We're able to check universality. All the three magnetic fields simulated have the same critical exponent. And we have checked even the Fisherson-Polinsky relation. This is the scaling between the critical magnetic field and the critical temperature. There are here. There are in blue. There are the numerical simulation, and in green is the result of the fit. There is a fit with only one free parameter. This A. The rest of the numbers in this scaling low, beta zero, gamma zero, T critical zero are the critical exponent and the critical temperature of the model in absence of magnetic field. However, if we apply again this R1-2 in the three dimensions, there is no phase transition in the correction length normal channel, like Peter Young has found in the past, but there is no phase transition in the new channel. So at the moment, there are no signal of phase transition in three dimensions. Yes. Okay, I will comment about this. Okay, I will finish the. Okay, we have a strong numerical evidence which support a phase transition below the upper critical dimension. In three dimensions, we have no signal for a equilibrium second order phase transition. But we have a strong evidence. Federico asked you in your seminar. There is an strong chain on the dynamics in three dimensions. We have published a detailed paper. We have found divergences of the relaxation time. So we have evidences of only a dynamical phase transition in presence of magnetic field, but not an equilibrium phase transition. So thank you very much for your attention.
In finite size systems, there is still a finite size scaling that can happen in the first order. You don't need a second order transition to
find
finite size scaling.
No, you can do finite scaling in first order transition, okay?
Yeah.
No problem.
You should see a first order transition.
No, the problem in a first order transition, the crossing point of the correlation length goes to zero because the correlation length asymptotically is a constant in a first order phase transition.
No, because the finite size effects of the spreading of the transition because of finite size effects.
No,
I think there's still a length scale.
No, but we are able to control this kind of effect. We can even compute with precision the correction to scaling omega, the first irrelevant eigenvalue in the renormalization group without problem in four dimensions. Okay. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.
Results in four dimensions in a magnetic field. Some methods of analysis give a transition, and some methods of analysis which should give the same results, but they don't give a transition. So why do you say the ones that are correct are the ones that show a transition? Mm-hmm. I mean, they should all be the same thing. Surely what you're seeing is very big corrections to scaling. And
okay. Now the situation is more or less the situation 20 years before in absence of magnetic field. The signal by the binder is really bad, but you need to use the correlation length in order to pick clearly the phase transition. You have a strong fineness effect on the binder cumulant than in the correlation length. So here our interpretation is due to this negative overlap effect. This negative overlap effect induced. This is computed at zero momenta, so that you pick the constant background, and here you have the constant background. So you are not in the asymptotic regime because you need to have at least a positive overlap for the probability distribution of the overlap. This is the at least for me, and the situation we have. Here we have a negative tail with a lot of probability to pick a negative overlap. So this induces large scaling correction in the propagator at zero momentum. So in order to avoid this bad behavior, you can avoid in the definition and introduce this new cumulant. We have test this new cumulant studying the four dimension with a magnetic field. We have studied even the Onsager model in two dimension. We are able even to compute exactly what is the value analytically of the crossing point. So for the point of view of critical phenomena is a good cumulant. And it's seen it has less scaling correction than the normal correction. But okay, this is
so you avoid using the k equals zero component, even though actually that is the one that is the most divergent. So,
but all the most near zero are diverging in the same way. Where? No, because in the where 2 pi over L, 2 pi over L, 2 pi over L. There are not an essential difference. Because L goes to infinite at 10. So you are finishing in the in Q equal to zero. This is the real divergence. Okay.
So a remark. There is a very simple argument due to Giorgio to explain this negative overlap. And the argument is the following, is that you, so what is, the, if you run Monte Carlo, what is the probability difference between positive and negative magnetization, for example, is exponential, the field times the magnetization times the volume. Okay, now if you put the numerical values of the field, the magnetization, and the volumes you are studying, you see that this relative probability difference is very small numerically. So, and that's the problem of small volumes, because if you had much larger, of course you cannot reach much larger volumes, but if you could reach much larger volumes, then the probability difference between positive and negative overlaps would be larger. So this is, you can understand this just looking to small, to numbers, mm-hmm. say why you get negative overlap contribution.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Let's thank you again.
André.